What we are going to do today is, I'm going to put different ways and means of how the evaluation can occur as such. I'm going to also discuss at times what are the problems with one particular type of system as such. And then finally, you are the best judge for your department and your system as such. Everyone has to come out with one's own system as such. I can set a paper for 2 hours, for 3 hours, giving the same weightage for the paper as such. 3 hour paper can be 50 marks paper, half an hour paper can be 50 marks paper, 2 hour paper can be also paper. What should I do? That's why finally individuals will have to come up with their own solutions to their own problems as such. But the idea is to look at these different aspects out here as such and see what are the problems, how we are going to look at. So we'll have a brief look at these different types of things as such. I am coming to these types of problems and things of that kind as such. I'm not restricting anything to any particular field or any such thing as such, but in general try to put the different aspects before you as such. When we think of problems, we need to categorize them as such. And what are the things? Maybe where the method and the solution is known. So if I'm going to give a problem as a test thing, something more complicated, but you know the methodology, you know also the solution maybe. Maybe the method is not known, but the solution is not known. Like if I give 3 into 3, 5, 9, that much most of us will be able to do. 3 into 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, if I put, no one is going to be able to give an immediate response like 3 threes are 9 as such. So you know the method, not that you don't know, but the solution, are you able to put it, spell it out immediately? No, it's not going to be possible for such things. This again I have to try to put out here. The simple examples can be basic arithmetic calculations. I'm not even coming to trigonometric or some such thing. I'm looking at only the simplest possible, which is possible to do as such. So arithmetic calculation. The other types, the method is known, but solution is not known. And what are these kinds? I am picking up the examples which I am picking up. Don't look at that set of examples as the only ones. These are the simplest ones which I have tried to pick up so that I can talk a bit about it, and there is no problem in looking at that example from any one of us. So solving a quadratic equation, you get two solutions. Okay, for any quadratic equation, you get two solutions. So which one is to be picked up? So again, you need a constraint out there as such. Whether a positive value is to be taken, a negative value is to be taken, or a higher value if both roots are positive, that is to be taken. What exactly needs to be done? So your problem is not going to be complete by just asking him to solve a quadratic equation. That may be possible for a lower level person as such. But if you are going to make use of that as one small step in your calculations, you must give some hint, some idea to the candidate or the student that he has to pick up particular value based on certain criteria as such. And then there are going to be certain things like the methods nor the solutions are known. So you ask him to solve some 7-degree polynomial as such. Something is given and now you also don't know what are going to be the values to start with as such. Unless you have taken that effort to solve it yourself first, this kind of thing happens. That you know that this is going to lead to some numbers as such, but you haven't done the calculations yourself. And then maybe it may happen that two of the roots turn out to be same. Out of some 7 roots, 2 roots may turn out to be same. Because that 7-degree polynomial may break finally into 2 quadratic equations from which one root may turn out to be. Now, who has thought about it? So, idea is we have to think about it. This part has to be done before the paper or question is set for a particular part as such. Once we do this setting part as such, let's briefly have solution and grading of the solutions as such. We'll look at some 2-3 very, very simple problems as such. I don't know whether you are having the write-up before you or not, but we'll look at it, and so I am trying to put very simple problems before you. But idea is, I am not suggesting a methodology to solve it. okay, it's all known to everyone out there. But my thinking is, how should we evaluate these kind of things? And from that angle, I tried to put out here very simple thing, simple multiplication, 2050 into 3. Only constraint is, no one is allowed the use of calculator or log table or any such thing. No Slido, I don't know how many, a few of our faculty members also may not have used the Slido possibly. So not even the Slido. So none of these things are available. So you have to go through your basic things and do the problem. So method one is all simple. This is what we normally follow. Okay. Method two, is it complicated compared to method one? No. Is it different than method one? Certainly. Has method one been derived from method two? Yes. Because multiplication, we keep on saying that so many times you add and you will get the product value as such. Okay. So we have done it exactly on the same lines. Only thing is, with this simple problem, I try to put it as one method, another method, and now how do I evaluate this once these things are done? My problem is only this. So in general, I will not be giving them any specific method to be used or something. They can use anything, whatever they feel like, it has to be correct, and two students come up with this. So they have used the different methods. Now look at it from this angle. I have not taught them the multiplication part at all. I have not taught them at this stage multiplication at all. I am still at the addition, subtraction stage only. And if someone comes with this multiplication method, should I give him the marks or should I tell him that this was not in the syllabus and you have used some method which is out of syllabus as such, so you can't get anything? What exactly should I do as such? In such cases, the problem is such, using either of the methods, you are getting the same solution. So your unique solution criteria is satisfied. Okay, methodology, you have not mentioned anything. What up at the problem level, what you have mentioned is only without the use of calculator. He has not used the calculator. It's very clear from this. Now, how do I grade them as such? Should I put the same marks as this for this method? Because the problem is basically the same. Now which route I follow, that may make the system more complicated or easier as such. And in such cases, some hints come into picture as such. Who will tell the student that this addition, where it was only 3 or the multiplier out there, so you could put the same number and add them up as such. What happens if the multiplier also becomes 2050? Can I write down this 2050 that many times and then go on adding it? Is it going to work as such? So no one is going to tell the student anything. You also have not put any constraint and on how exactly it should be done as such. But you know for sure that this first method which you are looking at is not the one which has been taught as yet. I am still in the preliminary stage of addition and subtraction part. So addition has been taught, this has not been taught. But we have just started with the multiplication and saying that 2050 into 3 means that you have to put 2050 3 times and add them up. So if he does it in this fashion, do I give him the marks or not? This is something which one has to look at as such. How one has to evaluate now, if I am putting certain marks, the difficulty level at each step has to be looked into. I am giving the examples which are very simple, very trivial. I know that. Okay, but the idea is the example should not become a problem as such. That's why I am giving such trivial examples out here. Look at this now, 123.3 into 21.3. The setup is somewhat similar, okay? There is not too much of difference except that second method, the addition method, is not going to work out here easily as such because the numbers are large, too many times one will have to wait, and the time is limited. So one will forego that or forget about that particular option of adding up the thing. So look at the various specific features out here. There is a correct solution. Normally what we do, let's first see what are the steps involved in this simple part. Again, keep in mind The problem is trivial one, but trivial problems also have evaluation problems. So I am now looking at this problem as assessment of this, how I should be going for. So first thing which I come across is I multiply this number by this 3, put it as an answer out here. Then go back to this, before multiplying and putting it here, I put 1, 0 or cross out here. Okay, that is an important step. If I don't put this 0 or cross here, the 1, 2, 3, 3 will fall below 3, 6, 9, 9. Things are going to be important. Next part, I have to put 2, 0 out here and then write down the thing. And then simply add them up, there the things don't end. I need to now know how many decimal places I had in this part. Accordingly, put the decimal places and put that decimal point after that point. So these are the splitters if I want to evaluate. Why I am doing all this? Because the incorrect solution, if I do not get this final value of 2626.29, should I give straightway 0 to that particular student, or does it deserve anything specific? And there the assessment part becomes important as such. And so now have a look at this. Up to this point, everything else is done properly. Okay? This 1 instead of 2, he by mistake has written 1. You know for sure that he has done multiplied it, this upper term, even with 3. So multiplication by 3 compared to multiplication by 2 is a difficult thing. Okay, at that level. So he has been able to do that. But he has not been able to do that with a lower level of difficulty. Still he is not in. So this 1 is wrong out here. Because this 1 is wrong, here again he has made one more mistake. He has not looked at the things properly. Instead of 2 coming here, because here he has made a mistake, same mistake is getting transferred here. And finally, the way we look at the various things as such, if I am looking at the class 3, class 4 students as such, I'll be expecting them that they should write the answer in this form. Okay? And then here again he makes one more mistake. Is this part the most important part to which we should give stepwise weightage? Or where should the stepwise weightage start? Again, here the things are again the same as such. So the steps involved have to be taken into account when you go for the evaluation. So looking at it, this product part which I was looking at, these two terms here is calculated very precisely. There is no problem, there is no error, nothing of that kind, no mistake out there. This one mistake has led to 1, 2, and 3 mistakes as such. Out of this mistake is the one which is getting carried forward as such. And so one has to look at again how exactly the thing should be done. Should I split the marks? Or should I have the total marks? If the correct answer is there, 10 out of 10, otherwise 0 out of 10. Is it really proper? There is something which the paper setter has to look at. And why this is becoming important is, paper setter's time or the examiner's or evaluator's time, lot of time is going to be required to see these things and split the marks stepwise. And that's why initially I talked about, if I am putting it in steps, do I mark marks for each step A, B, C, D, E, F, G or something? Or I put total marks there and then I have some discretion at this point. Should I have that discretion? Am I not questionable if I am using discretion? Today I finish up some 40 papers and sit down tomorrow, I am in a better mood. Maybe the discretion value changes as such. It happens. I have seen that happening with others, with me. I have gone through the papers second time because I knew that I am not doing something proper as such. How many of us really keep on doing it that carefully and regularly? Carefully, yes. Regularly, yes. Both things simultaneously, chances are very, very low. I am not commenting on anyone's capability or capacity. But the way we need to look at the answer books, sometimes 70 answer books, sometimes 100 answer books, within 2 days you have to finish the job of evaluation. you have to hand over the things because the end semester VIVA is coming or some such thing. So there are different constraints. Why exactly this is happening, I am not looking at that aspect. But the way it should be done, this kind of problem must be evaluated in stepwise patterns. How you give the marks, that's again left to the examiner or rather the paper set. If there are going to be 10 examiners, the paper setter is the one who has to give that backup of marks and not the evaluator. He must get it very precisely. If this is completed, these many marks. If this step is wrong, this should be cut. Now from here, we'll be coming to another aspect about this part. Please.
In a question paper, should we have objective type of questions or not exceeding 4 to 5 marks, or is it not necessary to have 10 marks question? This is second debating question,
I'll take that also into consideration while moving ahead. So somewhere halfway through you will get your answers. So last thing which we had seen was this, and we have seen that we need to bring in the stepwise answers at some stage or the other message. We'll discuss that at a little bit later point again before we come to another simple problem message. Again 999 into 999. Look at again, I am telling time and again that these are all trivial problems from the angle you are looking at. But I have put it here so that everything becomes clear to each and every participant, whether he is from this branch or that branch, should make no difference as far as these kind of problems are concerned. And as you see out here, the thing is given in a particular fashion as such. And so one can come out with the calculations and do certain things as well. There can be an alternative method, and this alternative method might not have been taught by you. Can this be something which becomes very difficult for acceptance for a teacher as such? I have not taught and he has used it. How come? Why should he do that? Why he did not use the method I had taught to him? These are some of the things which are always in the mind of the teachers as such. Because one thing is, you are not expecting an alternative answer, alternative method rather. But students can come up. Because they are learning 10 different courses simultaneously. You are teaching just one. And a methodology can be used from one course to another. And some such things can happen. And so, before putting a zero mark or putting just a cross or a line, cross line on the whole page, one should really think whether is there any thing in that as such. Does that answer really merit any consideration and win the marks as such? So if some such thing is put out here, 999 into 99, these are in the routine anyone can go through. Okay? But this is not something which everyone is going to do as such. Not everyone. Everyone knows this as well. Okay? At least this particular specific problem, all students from engineering side are aware of these parts. There is nothing unknown to them. But once you are asking it in this form, most probably almost 90-95% or even more are going to do it in this fashion. Should this fellow get the equivalent credit or not, if not more? And that if not more is something which one has to really think whether it's possible in our system. In our system, you cannot exceed 100% marks. Okay? So any innovative idea, any new methodology to give the same unique solution also may not fetch any additional advantage in terms of marks. What should one do that? We can't give him any more marks. He gets full marks if you agree with the arrangement that yes, he has done it with alternative method, but the method is correct. There are no mistakes, because things of this kind also happen, and they happen more frequently, that two mistakes cancel each other and you get the correct answer. Okay? This also is something which happens quite regularly. You change one answer, somewhere again you are putting it as minus, again you are adding it at somewhere. The whole thing gets cancelled out, your final result turns out to be correct. And now if you look at the stepwise evaluation, you cannot give him full marks. Because his intermediate steps are not correct. His final value, however, is matching. Does it mean that he has done the things correctly? No. He must get something deducted for those mistakes as well. So, if you are looking at the problem evaluation, saying that the final answer is correct means everything is correct, then you are mistaken. Most likely there is going to be a chance out of 20, at least one or two places, there are good chances that the mistakes are getting cancelled out and you are neither noticing the mistake nor the cancellation of that mistake. So, two mistakes you are committing when you are evaluating the answer sheet as well. One has to be extremely careful about these things. And so, one has to see whether the stepwise things are required or what exactly is to be done. After a moment, so one has to look at these aspects now. Logic and creativity. We use these terms left and right. Okay, time and again we say logically this should be the case. Creativity also we begin to picture at times. Basically, these two are the ones which can provide us a new approach as such to get the same solution. It can be possible. You can use logic, you can use creativity and get to that as such. The one which I showed just now, this alternative solution is something which he has not been told. Everyone is aware of this kind of thing, but not everyone is doing it in that fashion. So, maybe you may not call it as a innovation. It's not something new created, but as far as that particular person is concerned, it's an innovation for him, and you have to look at it as an innovation, a different methodology worked out for getting a particular answer as such. And in that case, the things have to be given weightage as such. So if you say that this was not the method by which I wanted the answer, that is not a very correct approach on our part as teachers as such. We have to accept, okay, I have taught it by one method, there can be another two methods available, possible, but they are not covered at this stage, so I didn't expect it. So on the other hand, you should be giving him full marks, and in the class tell that yes, he gets a pat on his back because he has used something different when he could have gone for that lengthy approach which was a simpler one. So certainly they deserve some additional appreciation for that and not only the marks. So there is something which becomes very, which is a very rare thing as such. So one has to keep that in mind. And every time is it going to be worthwhile doing it? So 999 into 999 was fine, only 1000 minus 1 kind of thing. Can I do it for 566 into 566 kind of thing and use the same methodology? Are we wasting a lot of time in doing that? So when a student is doing it, he doesn't know when exactly that approach should be used as such. Maybe if you tell him that last time he got a pat, so next time you put another problem, he will also do it on the same line. And what are you going to get? Maybe a mistake committed out there because the calculations involved are much more. And maybe no pat and a deduction of marks because of some wrong answers coming in us. So where exactly the innovation should be brought in? Every time is it not going to be advantageous or disadvantageous? That's something which the student has to think. We are not going to even know whether he has done it for another problem also or not. So you give a certain set of problems, you are going to evaluate only those. But this has to be known to that particular person as well. And so maybe once you are going for the distribution of answer books and taking the solutions in the class or something, that time one can clearly tell that this was the methodology used by one of you, but this is okay for this problem. Don't try it out when such things happen as such and things become more complicated. You may waste more time. Your innovative method will take much more time than the regular method which you are looking at. So try to see and work out the balance between the two as such. So once we look at this, when do these things become possible? This innovative approach which that one student has used as such, when is it going to be possible? They should get some time they should get some time to either have a look at the notes which they write within the class, or have a look at not just one textbook but additional 2-3 textbooks to get their ideas clear and improvise on what notes they have. It's not improvisation over your teaching, it's improvisation over what notes they have taken down in the class. Everything may not get properly covered in the class, and I must accept that. I must accept that whatever I have planned for a particular lecture, each and everything may not get covered in each and every class. Some classes, a part of it, few points we can miss. It's possible, and it's generally possible, and generally happens than not happening. That possibility of that happening is more than 50%. Rather than saying it's less than 50%. Some small points which you at the beginning of the lecture you have in mind that I'm going to talk about this 15 things, and one or two things get left out. If that gets covered in the next lecture, fine. But if the lecture gap between the two lectures is a lot, in that case most probably that will get just skipped off your mind as such, and that will not be noticed by you nor by the students as such. And so such things can happen, and so the student should get some time to go through these particular things, and then only if he is in position to get some time, that will give him some chance to come out with some new methodologies or small changes which can reduce the time required for a given solution or the answers. As I indicated, there are studies which have been conducted on problem solving and their implications as such. And here the indirect way, we already started with this particular approach as such. I have not brought this particular methodology or anything at the moment as such. We are already working on it. The possession of the problem by the student is really an important one as such. How he looks at that problem as such. And based on the problem perception, the student tries to find the links between various data. Our things, normally what I am looking at is the analytical problems as such, in the sense the numericals and things of that kind. And I am not touching also on the descriptive type of things as such. Descriptive type of things have to be as less as possible. They have to be covered in the class, but the questions weightage should be somewhat less on that as such, because repetition of the things, they write pages after pages if it is a descriptive question. I have gone through that student time as such, and I have also written and got the marks also for that, but those questions should not have been given that kind of weightage. That is my feeling which I am having now. For the questions which I answered 25-30 years back, for those questions I am still feeling that those questions didn't deserve that many marks. And that kind of detailed write-up kind of thing, for writing about the boilers and lathe machine sketch and shaping machine, slaughter machine, all such things, you draw the sketch, draw it for 10 minutes, you waste in that, write about 3 pages mentioning each and everything. Does it really deserve that kind of attention as such? Does it really deserve that many marks for that particular part? The same principles can be finished with a 5-line, 4-line gap, as I said, in the question paper, if it is a question come answer paper. Otherwise, very specific instructions that this answer should not stretch beyond 5 lines or 6 lines. 5 lines or 6 lines. Then let him write in the smallest possible letter. You have to be prepared to read the smallest size letter out there. But lines number is fixed. So he cannot write an essay on those things. And that is something which we have to tell them. We have to define how the things have to be written. And that part also will be coming to little bit later. Once he comes up with the links within the various problems, sometimes the intuition of the student also can give him an advantage that if I do this, the answer was like that. So let me not proceed in the normal fashion, but straightway maybe instead of calculating something, let me assume some value and show that it is the same value. Okay? So certain things are there which are all intuitional. Everything will not be occurring every now and then. But these kind of cases we come across time and again. Instead of calculating it through the steps, he finds an easier way. He takes the final answer, assumes that, and shows that that matches the things perfectly. So he uses one or two conditions to satisfy the requirements, and he has done the problem. Now, should he get full marks? Should he get full marks? Yes, method is not proper. Intuition is not acceptable in engineering calculations. Intuition is not acceptable. You might have jumped on to the very precise exact number and all that, but you cannot justify that. Why that particular value to start with? If you have some reasoning that okay, my answer is expected to be between 9 and 10, and so I am looking at 9.5 as my first assumption, then he can get it. But he doesn't know value at all, whether it's 1 to 100 or 1 to 1000, and he is taking that 9.5. He has no way to explain how he has come out with that. And such answers, even though correct, cannot get full marks. Whether to give 0 or not depends on the actual problem and definition and how the methodology is working out or some such thing. But intuition sometimes can work, that yes, I know that value has to be between root 2 and 1 or some such thing. And I am picking up this value as the first value. If it doesn't work, I will go for the second iteration, change it slightly, again try it out. And then he gets the things matching in the first iteration, you have to give him the full credit. So there are problems both ways. Can I give him full marks? In certain cases, yes. Can I give him 0? In certain cases, yes. So that is no very clear cut answer except for the paper setter to come out with us. There is no very clear cut answer that this cannot be acceptable or this has to be done because he has got the correct answer. No, both ways one has to think and then take a decision out there. What to do to imbibe problem solving? Till now we have looked at only the problem solving part. Okay, but we have in engineering lot of things which we do, and our intention, whether knowingly or unknowingly, we are doing it as such. Like what? We ask the students to draw the angles of say 30 degrees, 45 degrees, 60 degrees, 75 degrees, 90 degrees, okay? All these things with a protractor, a third or fourth standard or maybe fifth standard student can easily do it now. Okay, but you are asking him to do it with set squares. No more use of protractor. Okay, like in the first case I have said, no calculator, nothing of that kind. Use your brains and do it. Similarly, now use your brains and not the protractor but the set squares, which is a major drawing instrument set, and come out with the angles of 30, 45, 60. Some of these are directly available. Some additions, subtractions, and you have to place the set squares this way, that way, and you can get different types of angles. So it's possible to get it without the protractor. But then you teach them something additional, the bisection of angle and things of that kind. So you draw a 90 degree angle and bisect it and you get 45 degree angle. But now you are not using protractor or set square for that purpose. Or there are different ways in which you go for polygons and other things as well. So you are teaching them how to go for problem solving when this is not available, that is not available. You are teaching them one by one. But they are looking at it as one more input as such and nothing else. It's not taken in by the students also in the same way that they should look at it as such. They are not looking at it as additional method without using protractor, without using set square. They think that there is one more method available. Okay? But the constraints or the requirements are different. If the protector is available, I will never draw 130 degree angle with anything else. That is anyway difficult to draw with any other method, but I will never try to do that. But these methods have to be looked at in that angle. Similarly, the problem solving needs to be forming the part of a syllabus, or rather teaching part. It cannot become a part of the syllabus as such, but we have to imbibe in ourselves to teach certain things out there to give them ideas how they should go about solving the problems. Innovations is also one more thing. So how to tackle a new problem as such? So when we look at a new problem, the first thing is the knowledge about the subject matter and practice in one particular context. You have used the angle drawing things in engineering drawing. Do you restrict that knowledge to only engineering drawing? Unless you have a sheet and the set squares and other things, you will not use it. It has to get used somewhere else wherever that need arises. So one has to be clear that that knowledge which is available with you has to be used, and you have that knowledge as such. So when will this start in the student feels that he is in position to do this as such? And when the student will be in position to do that, we'll see that in a moment as such. So use of knowledge in the given context that he knows as such. Can he apply that to a new problem? That is something again one has to look at. So these things are some of the things which are causing problems with the students. Some misconceptions. I'm going to have a look at one or two small examples out there. Some missing links. And finally, even if all these things are clear, he gets into problem where he cannot form the equations as such. And as we all talk about, mathematics is very important when if one goes for engineering. Whether he goes for mechanical or electrical or civil doesn't matter. But mathematics has to be strong, and that comes where the conversion to equations form becomes the regular feature as such. Each and everything, the data has to be converted to equation form, whether it's simple algebraic equation, trigonometric equations, differential equations, integration. Somehow or the other, you have to bring it to that form, then come out with the solution and reconvert that equation form back to your text form or the final values form. So there he gets stuck. And so we need to now look at how to motivate the students to go for these different things as such. He should get that confidence that he can do the things as such on his own. And what is going to do that? This motivation part also, word also I heard in the morning. These slides are prepared much earlier as such. Okay, so you have to be in position to motivate him, and in that sense he must get confidence that he can do it as such. That is the motivation step. If you are getting, how does one get into that? As you ask him to solve one or two simpler problems in a tutorial sheet to start with, where whatever information you are given in the class, the same is getting used to start with. Now he gets a feel that yes, he can use the information which has been provided by the teacher. Now then you put a slightly tougher problem as such, where the complexity is increased, but still they are not beyond his reach. Misconceptions. I am just trying to put one or two simple things. Very recently, most of you, if not all, must have gone to the cricket matches. And I just put one small example out here. Cricket ball and bowler's hand move in the same direction. Okay? Everyone knows that. What is so funny about it? Your Newton's second law says that the action and reaction should be equal. So if the ball is moving in one direction, the hand should move in the other direction. Okay? Shouldn't it happen that way? It should happen in that way as per the Newton's law. But can Newton's law be looked at as a single thing controlling everything? There are additional things which are coming in. Momentum transfer. These kind of things, are everything being considered and under that Newton's second law or something, one has to think about it. You will all be in position to explain to your students that no, Newton's law holds good, but this is not the case where you have to apply the Newton's law, right? So that is the kind of thing, and that happens why? Because when the sleep spindle catches a ball, it then automatically goes closer to his body. So now the ball has hit and the hand has moved in the opposite. So things are working in different cases. So one has to see how these kind of things are, these misconceptions are sorted out. one will not know these things unless the students are open to you. And there is something which is very difficult thing in engineering colleges I have seen, because the faculty members in engineering colleges have to teach maybe 6, 7, 8 different subjects for different levels, not like us that we stick to our specialization, maybe taking 4 or 5 courses but of similar type at different levels, but never losing the temper out here, because we have enough time to spend on that and we do that as such. And there is really something which is not an individual's problem as such. The situation, the conditions are like that 6, 7 different courses have to be taken. The faculty member is not in position to concentrate on each one of them. And then I have seen this happening not only as a student, but sitting at the back of the class also. The teacher getting irritated if some student asks some questions. And if he shouts back at the student, after that the whole year no other student is going to ask you a single question. There is something which happens, and there is something which has to be avoided altogether. This must be avoided. Must give a chance to students to come out with their doubts. At times I have heard comments, oh, that was a really silly question. Yes, but now he knows that it was a silly question because he got the response and explanation for it. Till that, no question is a silly question unless one gets a exact proper response for that particular part. So please let your students ask questions. Reassure them that they will not have any effect, odd effect, because they have asked questions. They will not get singled out because they have asked questions. You need to do it for each and every batch, for each and every course. We do it here, at least I do it here regularly. I tell you also, I had put a slide, please do not hesitate to ask questions. No question is a silly question. Don't think that way. Don't hesitate to ask. If you hesitate to ask, you are going to go without that information throughout. If you couldn't ask me or the colleagues out here, you are not going to ask to anyone throughout your life. With this group, if you cannot be open, with whom can you be open as such? And you have to say that you don't know the answer. Without that, you will not be in position to ask anyone as such. If you ask, the right time is the class. Or outside, you can go and ask the teacher if you are so scared of some mob or the other lot which is there. So that is something which one has to avoid. I just tried to put one or two examples which we looked at. Looking at this taxonomic scheme now. Taxonomy is basically the practice and science of classification. It's a Greek words being put together, and I have tried to include out there. This was basically used for classifying living organisms to start with. But then this term is getting used more and more often for different applications and systems approaches. The term is now used in a wider, more general sense and can be put for anything. So our classification for problem solving scheme, we are going to have it in this problem part as such. There are certain things which we are going to define, which are sort of expected things in the system as such. And one of them is what we call as the routines. Most of you, almost every one of you, must be aware what are the subroutines in programming. Okay, one way of programming one language or the other, you are all aware of subroutines. There is nothing but exactly the same thing put out here. These are very simple steps which do the calculations in a normal way as such, or decision making in a normal fashion, without coming out with the decision on its own as such. So it's finally going to give you some value. If it is in the form of yes, no kind of thing, it will say yes or no kind. But no decisions are available from this. And what you are doing now? So you are going to use them regularly, like I am going to use quadratic equation solution, a small subroutine for that. That I am calling out here in this methodology as a routine, which in our computer programming we call as a subroutine. Okay, small, small programs we write and we incorporate them at any place we want, and we get the answer that exact problem part or the subroutine part stays outside the main program in a way. We call that subroutine or routine and do the same. Exactly the same thing here, except that here also we do not get any decision from that. We only get the values from it. So what are the things which we have out here? The scheme is basically adopted from Vankat and others, and it consists of four different steps, as say, the diagnosis, the strategy, the interpretation, and then the generation. Let's look at briefly at each one of them. It's the selection of the correct way to use a routine. If I want to solve a quadratic equation, which routine should I use? I may not have only one main method or routine available. I may be having 2, 3, 4 different routines. It's not just not for the quadratic equation, for anything as such. So integration, differentiation, area calculations, these are all these things are coming under these routines parts. So having appropriate knowledge of these routines, the diagnosis is getting completed. In the sense, I have now chosen for a given problem what methodology or what split procedure I need to go for. Strategy is the choice of routines. So we will need to look at the, so we will be going through the strategy part, we will be having the choice of routines considered out there as such. Interpretation is a real world problem solving as such. Reducing a real world problem to a representation of one so that it can be solved. As I said, converting things to equation forms and things of that kind. That is the interpretation. And finally, we end up with certain conditions as such. If you get, for example, negative values of mass, length, pressure, are these the realistic values? No, you cannot have negative mass, you cannot have negative length or some such thing, negative current. You cannot have that kind of things as such. So those are the things which are wrong. So those should give you some clear-cut idea where the things are going wrong as such. Finally, the generation is the development of routines which can be used for a new user as such. And this may again involve stringing them together. You can have 4 or 5 routines brought together and form a new routine as such. So that is something which will be handy. Let's have a brief look at the designing and grading problems as such. The problem is considered as good if it gives the serves or fits the objectives for which you have set that particular thing as such, and allows for proper grading as well. The scheme which we have to follow for doing this is going to be little bit different than what we normally do as such. How to use the taxonomic scheme? Now in this, when you are setting a question paper of 5 or 6 things, questions as such, but on a very limited area of the syllabus, you have to start with the simpler questions to get started. The idea is to test them, that is one part, to help them is another part. Okay, these two things are normally not going together. Either you test them or you help them, and people look at it as if you do one, the other is not possible. Not true. You have to ensure that they get the help by way of the evaluation process, or in the process, the feedback, they should get help from this. So try to put the questions in increasing order of difficulty. Don't put the toughest question right in the first instance. He is going to have a look at, our intention is always to go from top to bottom. Question 1 to the page end and change the page and go for the next. No one is going to have a look at the last question first kind of thing. So don't sort of disturb the candidate or student in the very first instance by keeping the toughest problem in the beginning. Let him go through the things. As the difficulty level builds up, his confidence level also is building up. Well, he gets the simplest question, you need not put equal marks for all questions. That is one criteria through which you can always be in position to do this. Put 7 questions, 8 questions, but first 5 questions may be giving you a weightage of maybe 40%. last three questions may be having separate weightage of 60%. But then you are not killing the interest of the student, he is getting something possible to be done to start with and then go by that asset. Grading or evaluation part, it's an unavoidable feature as such. No one wants to do this. Okay? It's not a process which any teacher generally likes as such. And especially grading a batch of something like 60, 80 or 120, it's more problematic, takes a lot of time, and so one has to think what exactly is to be done. So ranking of students is anyway required. That is an essential feature of our system as such. And the students who can really put their abilities into problem solving should be getting higher marks or something. So things have to be done in that fashion as well. So if we start with the earlier problems as such, now let's look at what are the common problems which we encounter as such. I indicated that with the examples which I have put in the beginning, the multiplication problems as such, very simple errors I had indicated. Should the student get 0 marks for that kind of thing, or should he get some credit? Now here there is a difference. Some people, there are methodologies which have been put in the literature as well, that you go by addition or deletion. Addition in the sense, you start looking from the beginning of the answer, how many correct steps has he done. So if he has gone up to step 3, stop at that. Whatever the marks you have allotted for those 3 steps, give them that, and that's done. There is a deletion step, where you go through all the steps and see where the mark should be deducted. Like in our case of what we had seen, one of the features which is possible is, you know that this particular step onwards all values are wrong. But values and steps, they are not the same. Keep that in mind, that values and steps are not the same. Values are numbers, steps are the procedures as such. Okay, so stepwise procedure may be still correct, but with wrong value he has started, so beyond a particular point he doesn't get anything. There are people who talk of this thing, that if you go for 3 wrong steps, after that you need not look at the remaining part of the problem at all, because after that you don't normally expect anything to fall in a line as such, or anything turning out to be correct. So you allow for 3 errors to occur, till that time you must check. Beyond that you can just say that anything beyond that is not going to be correct or expected to be correct. So the opinions are going to be different out here. Everyone is going to have a different opinion. Whether one should go for a particular value of marks to be given to a particular step or not is not very clear. And that's what I have said, positive and negative marking schemes. Either you keep on adding the correct thing or you go on deleting for negative parts as such. Possibility of multiple solutions and methods. This is something which you should never neglect as such. Never cross the answer just because your value expected is not coming as such. Something which is expectedly wrong also you will have to go through as such. And then tackle that particular part and see whether there is any alternate method available. You may be knowing about one alternate method, but keep in mind you are not the only ones who have learned the things as such. The students also have learned the things, not from the same teachers as ours, but from different teachers who are going to be your colleagues, and they can give different ideas out there. Finally, error-free solutions are the easiest to check. No error, averaging tick, 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 10 marks. The whole thing gets done within no time as such. Error in the first step, everything later you have to check as such. So error-free things are always easy. And when this error occurs early in the solution, one should strictly speaking track the error through. Why that error has occurred? The feedback part which I was talking about comes at this stage out here as such. You have to say that this value you have taken is wrong. You can't say that this is wrong. Very pinpointedly you must point out that this is what is wrong and you should have taken instead of this, that would have turned out to be correct. This takes long time. This takes long time. And so what you should do is these errors are occurring because of these three different types of assets. Some lapses, some knowledge errors, there is something misconception or things of that kind, or the rule errors, which are basically the multiplication, division or numbers. And distinctions are not always easy. Distincting one thing from the other is not easy. When he brings the paper to you saying that you are given less marks, you start asking him questions and you may finally feel that I had deducted the marks for this purpose, for that he should have got it, but for this he should not get it again. So even that kind of thing happens, so our perception as far as that part is one. Finally, well presented solutions are always easier to evaluate, and these never get neglected as such. You will find in your class students, in a solution which is given, there will be one step here, side by side, there is a third step given here, and the whole thing hodgepodge. You are not in position to link the things as such. And you also behind the students who are writing it in very neat form. Neat in the sense, I am not talking about good handwriting, good sketches, no. Handwriting may be bad, that he cannot help. Sketches, drawing may be bad, but his arrows and such things, if he is showing a current or flow direction, it will be there. In other student's case, the whole thing will be neatly, nicely, nicely done with the scale, but there will not be any direction indicators out there. In such cases, which is the one which is to be looked at as a good? The one which is not looking good but is more correct has to be given that kind of weightage. So marks, at times people try to train the students that I am going to do this this time for this test. If your solution is not well presented, you are going to get marks deducted. Answers may be correct. So I may add some 2 marks specifically for that and do that as well. So that is something which one has to look at. Finally, after all this process and evaluation and all that, the feedback has to go to the students as such. And they must realize where and why the errors have occurred and marks have been deducted or given. So that part is something very important. And here, a small note, maybe a word or two at each point where you are going to put a mark, cross mark, you know what is wrong at that stage. Only thing is a slight laziness from the teacher's side. Forgive me if I am using a wrong word, but from my angle, I look at it as slight laziness, not too much of laziness. Instead of putting a mark, if I write this particular parameter, then when the student comes back to you, you don't have to look at that part again. You know what was wrong with that. And you can immediately, within no time, you can send the student back. You have not used this parameter correct, and so the mark has been deducted. Otherwise, you have to really scratch your head and see why did I put that cross that time. And at times, if it is, the students are also clever. Don't look at them as always a fools as such. That fellow will not come immediately when you have checked the answer. He will come after 15 days. By that time, you have forgotten what solutions you had marked as. And then it really becomes tough to do that. So a similar thing one has to do for a tutorial sheet as such. To start with a basic repetition of knowledge, and then little bit more difficulty level has to be brought in as such. And problem solving strategies, as we looked at, there is something which has to be done as such. Whether one can check the solution or not, that is left to an individual. Here comes the crux of the thing as such. You have the alternative forms of assessment. Someone was asking as to, can we do this, can we do that? Yes, you can do all different things as such, but all with the information to the students to start with. That is something which you cannot put. We do have something different. We have what we call as a surprise test. We tell them that next month, anytime there will be a surprise test. And without telling them what particular part, of course we give them the quantum of course part which is going to be there. But other than that, they don't have. So we have the open book examination. When you give the open book examination, you are not going to give any descriptive type of questions out there. Concept checking or concept evaluation is something for which you will have to really put in some more time to set those papers aside. Incomplete solutions, I have tried it. Give them incomplete solutions. Give the problem, give the some 3-4 steps and ask them to proceed further. And they will get stuck somewhere because they are not looked at those 4 steps which have been solved and given them in the proper correct way. So they, you can ask for the self-marked assignments, like when we have a very small number, that time we do this thing also. Okay, you exchange the answer sheets. You evaluate for him, you evaluate for him. We get the carbon copy made out of this, okay, and give those things. If I feel somewhere something is wrong, I can check that as such. So no problems on that. So even within them, when they are doing it, they cannot cheat the teacher as such. Teacher teaches or they cheat. That is what people normally think. Not all the time it may be possible as such. You can have the checks out there. Finally, coming to this innovations and patents part, as people were looking at it. How does one come up with any of these as such? There is something which one has to look at more carefully as such. And how does one confirm that he has really got something worth calling innovation? So what to call innovation? Just changing one, instead of using a metallic rod, if I put a wooden pencil instead of that, and if the pencil doesn't break, can I call it innovation? No, everything cannot be called. You can modify the things, you can modify the objects, modify the things as such. Innovation is something different as such. You have come up with a totally new idea to do something which is desired as such. It may not be a new object and totally new thing as such. And so, what leads to patents is this gets checked by the patent examiner as such, whether anything is available already or not. And so from that angle, we will be in position to get to the other things as such.